Hey guys, I am here to do another review for you, and today I would like to talk about The Goddess Chronicle by Natsuo Kirino. I heard about Natsuo Kirino because a professor of mine recommended Out as a great work of modern Japanese fiction, so I was really excited about it. It is a crime novel that is extremely feminist, not only in its really original and strong female protagonists, but also in that it addresses a lot of really important social problems that are going on in contemporary Japan that we might not often hear about or know of. And this is the impression that I've had of Kirino. Before this, I'd only read that one book, and I absolutely loved it. So I wanted to read more of her works, and this sounded really interesting, but it is so different from Out. So if you've read Out, forget everything that you know about Kirino, because this is a whole different ballgame. This is a retelling of the Japanese creation myth. The description on the back and the description that's found on places like Amazon or Goodreads talk about it as a myth. They never allude to the fact that it takes place in Japan or that it is using very commonly well-known gods in their story. I assumed, just from the descriptions that I had read, that it was entirely a work of Kirino's own imagination, but no, it's actually a retelling. I'm not actually very familiar with the Japanese creation myth. I know a little bit about it, but not a lot, so I do not know how much this strays from that or how it differs, but I can assume that its emphasis on the women's side of the story, as well as its feminist tone, are probably not found in the original Kojiki text. The one thing that does not differ from Out is Kirino's clear desire to express what women actually go through, women's feelings. And yes, this is thousands of years ago Japan, and it takes place in a mythological space, so it's not exactly based on truth or fact, but it is so human. That's something that I really enjoyed about it. If you've read other mythology, this is going to be very familiar. The gods are extremely human. They have a lot of emotions. They have history with each other and complicated relationship issues. And this is evidenced in here. And it takes an interesting perspective. I don't know much about the Japanese creation myth, but I'm assuming it doesn't take the same perspective as this does. It starts off on a tiny island in the Japanese archipelago. Japan's not a unified country, of course. It's just a chain of islands. And there is one island that is said to have been where the gods were born, and our story starts on this island long after creation. Humans are existing, and we start with a young girl who is the granddaughter of the island's oracle. There are a lot of mysteries and secrets in terms of what the oracle actually does and what her role is and how she fulfills it, but our protagonist is only 5 or 6 years old, so of course she doesn't really understand all the nuances, but from a very young age she is told that she is impure and that she is tainted. She doesn't understand what this means, but obviously it kind of crushes her self-esteem, and her older sister is going to be next in line to be the oracle. And our protagonist doesn't really know what her part in the role is. She's just told that everything has two halves, your sister is going to be the next oracle, and you are impure. It goes from there. Eventually she actually does touch more on the creation myth itself, which is about Izanagi and Izanami, who were not the first gods, but were the first lovers. They were the first gods to sexually reproduce, so a lot of the gods that they created were created from sex, as opposed to they themselves and other gods before them who were just created out of asexual reproduction. It's not an objective telling of the story. It definitely sides with Izanami, who is the goddess of the underworld. She is trapped there, and she was trapped there by her husband Izanagi, so she's not very happy about that. And the story's kind of weave in and out. There's some magic stuff that happens. I mean, it is a myth, so it's not entirely based in reality, but it's quite enjoyable. I would highly recommend it if you are a fan of mythology. This is maybe not something that you're very familiar with. The publisher that printed this is Canon Gate. They publish things that specifically address mythology, so they've also published a work by Margaret Atwood, they've published a work by Michelle Faber, and a lot of different others. I think it's an interesting subject matter to tackle, and I think this is a great one if you are interested in mythology, because if you are, you probably are very familiar with Greek and Roman mythologies, but this might be new territory for you. Like a myth, it's not the most complex or sophisticated of writing. It's quite simple, but it's beautiful in its simplicity. It's almost 300 pages long. but the print is extremely large and the margins are also quite large, so you could blow through this in a day or two very fast, but quite interesting, not only in that I didn't really know much about the Japanese creation myth before, but also the feminist perspective in which Kirino observes it, which I think is quite an interesting side to take, and just makes me all the more excited to read more of Kirino's works, and I hope so much that more of them are translated, because she's written 20 books in Japanese, but only 4 or 5 of them have ever been translated, so I'm really excited to read more of her stuff. I would recommend this if any of that sounded interesting to you, especially if you liked any of Kirino's other works. This is not exactly in the same vein as those, but it's still Kirino at the core, so, you know. Also, like I said, if you're into mythology, or just in general, if this sounded interesting to you, it is a work in translation, it is by a woman of color, so it checks some diversity boxes if that's what you're looking for. Even if that's not what you're going for at all, I still find it quite enjoyable, and I would recommend it. I didn't love it as much as I loved Out, I will admit that. It's not going to end up on my favorite shelf, and it's probably not going to be in my top books of the year, but it was a good read, and I enjoyed it, so. Thank you guys for watching, and I will see you next time. Bye.